Okay, it is Wednesday afternoon, July 28th, and we are lesson number 16 on the Gospel and the Stars, and we believe this will be our grand finale. We'll see how we do, but we think that's where we're coming. So, in a quick review from class, last week we were under the sign of Gemini, the twins. We looked there and saw that it's the twofold nature of the king. We also saw that it could be the bridegroom and the bride, which would be Messiah, Yeshua, Jesus, and the called out assembly, or the church that it could be. It could be showing God the Father and God the Son sitting on the throne together. There were many ways that we could look at these two, but we definitely know that we see the messianic reign during this book that we're in. This is the third book. The Redeemer, His Second Coming, so I tend to see it in that view especially. We looked at the first constellation underneath called Lepus. Lepus is the hare, H-A-R-E. It's the rabbit, the hare. And we saw that it's a gigantic rabbit, but it's scared. And it's a picture really of the enemy being bound. This is Satan being put in a bottomless pit for the thousand-year millennial reign of Shalom, of peace on the earth. Lepus is under the foot of Orion. We looked at it last week. If you're looking on the screen, we're on the bottom left for me. There you go. Lepus is under the foot of Orion. Orion, we know, is a picture of the Lord, and the foot on Lepus is about ready to crush his head, Genesis 3:15. When we look at the next decon, constellation under Gemini, it is Canis Major. This is the wolf or the dog. If you don't like that, you can call it Sirius, S-I-R-I-U-S, which means the prince. We know that when we say Sar Shalom, Prince of Peace, Sar and Seer and Sirius are all off that same root. We saw that there is a star in Canis Major that is called Sirius. It is actually a two-star system. The magnitude, the size, the heat was phenomenal. We won't go into all those details, but remember that's where I said the pressure, the gravity pressure on star B, which isn't as big and as bright as star A, would make a sugar cube weigh 2,200 pounds, if you remember that last week. It's 71% larger than the sun. It's 18,000 degrees Fahrenheit, just for some of the details. One of the stars, because the star system is a two-star, we think it's one, but when you get up there, you see it's two. One is two times hotter than the sun. One is five times hotter than the sun. We know that our coming glorious Prince of Peace is brighter than the sun. We know that this wolf or dog is the hunter or the devourer of the hare. And we know that our Prince of Peace, our Sar Shalom, to bring peace, is going to be the devourer of the enemy. This shows him in his victorious rule. It shows him as the bright and shining star. We talked about that last week also, so I won't go into detail now. And we saw that the stars in it also talk about the sent prince. In the Hebrew, it's Nazir or Netzer. It comes down to Nazarene. It's the fulfillment where he is called a Nazarene in Matthew, fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah 11:1, where he would be the rod that stems forth from Jesse, the one that's called the branch. So we know all of this brings us to know this is a picture of Messiah. This is a picture of our Savior. Canis Minor is the second dog or the second wolf. This one shows him as exalted Redeemer. Again, there's two natures that are seen in it. He was slain, that's the first coming, and he's seen as the glorious triumphant Redeemer returning. So the two comings are seen. The first one, which Canis Minor is showing in the Exalted Redeemer, shows that he was burdened, one of the names of the stars. He bore our sins. Enduring for others, he endured the pain of the cross, and I mean, yes, physically, of course, but I mean spiritually, becoming sin sacrifice for us. He was loaded down, but he also is the Prince of the Ruler who completes it in perfection. All these names of stars in that constellation to show us that he's gone from being a little lower than the angels in his suffering state to being brought up, seated on high with the Father, the glorious one, the triumphant one, the exalted Redeemer. That brought us into Cancer. Cancer is an enigma as to why it really is a picture of a crab today. It is called the crab today, so we recognize that. but we saw that it really was from the ancient zodiacs, better to describe it as the scarab, the beetle. You would think, I give up, why a beetle? And it is disgusting to those of us who feel that way. That's because it is a picture of resurrection. It's a picture of death. The beetle, the scarab, lives its life lowly in the dust of the earth, literally eating dust and working with dust its life until it goes into a cocoon-like state. When it breaks out of the chrysalis, it is able to soar in the heavens. It's not any longer earthbound. And it looks like it has died inside, it stayed alive, but it has to get rid of that outer shell to bring its life out. So in this, we see a picture of death, burial, resurrection. We know even the mummies that were buried, they'd take out all the insides, but they would leave the heart, and then they would put a picture of the scarab over the heart. It was believed that the scarab could even bring power to that heart and bring that heart back to life. So the only one that's come back to life is Yeshua Jesus, unless he miraculously, we have the few stories in our Bible that we know overall. And the only one who can give us life is Yeshua Jesus when he came back in that abundant life for us. Cancer, if you broke down the word, is really con, and either cur or concert, spelled with K's, little different than what we're used to, means the traveler's resting place. The Hebrew word for it is novel, and that is the fold. It is a pleasant place. It doesn't mean a fold in your clothes. It means like the sheepfold. We saw that in Cancer is a cluster of stars called the beehive, so numerous that it's reminding us of the innumerable seed that will be brought into the sheepfold, sheltering in place. That's all the people through all time who have been saved, that the Lord brings them in. We see again that the body of Christ throws off that old shell where we're bound to earth in our earthly form, and we will soar into the heavens also, much like the scarab, when we take on our resurrected newness of life when we meet the Lord face to face. Some actually see, and I'm saying it, I'm not cussing, but the asses, the wild donkeys, okay? Some see that in the picture instead of what I've been saying. That would relate to Genesis 49, to the tribe called Yisachar. That would be because it says there that they were rejoicing in their tents, and it said that they were between the sheepfold. So again, it's a place of safety, a place of rejoicing. We could look at it, if we look at that view, as being the messianic blessings in the pleasant land for the people of God. That will be the 1,000-year reign in Israel, where Israel will be brought up as the head nation of the world. She is not, no matter what the lies are out there today, Israel is not head nation, nor is the Jew in charge of the money of this world and bringing you COVID and all the other problems that you're hearing from the lies that are going out. But one day God will fulfill his promises and through the nation of Israel bless the world. Remember, in Abraham they would all be blessed. So this is what we're seeing in the scene, in the picture here that we have been talking about. We also saw that the head of Hydra the serpent, who is Satan, is under the foot of this crab, and the crab will be coming down as if to crush it. Under Cancer, the three decons are first Ursa Minor, the lesser bear, then we'll have Ursa Major, the greater bear. This is where we find our Big Dipper and Little Dipper. I put them in the wrong place last week, so make sure you get that right this week. When we're looking at the sheepfold in Ursa Minor, in the minor one, we have the polar star. That polar star has moved from being in the picture of Draco the dragon to being just about in the sheepfold now. That's a very interesting move. We'll talk about in depth again in just a moment. We kind of did last week, but we'll add a little bit more to it this week. There are two sheepfolds because we've got the big and the little. That could be Israel and the called out assembly that we call the church. Some see it as Israel, the 10 tribes, and Judah, the two tribes. Whichever way you can look at it, that's fine. Just know the sheepfold is a secure place. We've got the shepherd protecting the sheep. Now, we're going to pick up with that polar star. That polar star is also called Rekuba. It's called Thuban. In Ursa Minor, Thuban is united. And Cepheus, our king that we saw much earlier in our study, has his foot on the polar star, not to crush it, but it's showing that the king is in control. Okay, so if we saw above the polar star, we would see Cepheus up there. Okay, so I think I've told you all you need. The star names in Ursa Major, the great sheepfold, are purchased flock, visited, guarded, numbered, and in an enclosed place assembled. That I can see for us. The Lord redeemed us. He purchased us. We are his possession. He visited us in his first coming to do that. He guards us. He even numbers us, knows us all. If he knows the stars by name, names all them, you don't think he knows our names and knows where we are and what's going on? And he keeps us safe now, but he will bring us home to be in the sheepfold with him forever in a closed place where we will assemble. So great, beautiful, beautiful picture. But we're going to talk just a little bit more now about that polar star, and then we will look at Argo, the ship, if you're wanting to get ready. Loretta, you have a question.
Yes, I want to know, you mentioned about he put his foot, I don't see a foot, where he put his foot on, I suppose confusing.
Okay, if you find Cepheus, you find the king, I don't see him up here right now, or do I? Is he? He is.
Who is it?
He is. He's upside down right now. Go down, Roger, go down, see the foot. There you go, circle the foot.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Circle his foot and the tail of what looks like a dog or a bear or whatever. Mm-hmm. That's
okay,
Ursa
okay.
Minor, okay? The star that's lined up with the foot in the tail, that's the polar star. That's what we're talking about, okay?
That's right.
All right, so now, again, as a review, but as I'll add a little more layer to it, when the constellations were formed, or when we're made aware of it, we have Draco, the dragon, possessing the polar star, okay? Or the North Star called Thuban. Thuban, I told you wrong a minute ago, Thuban is subtle. He was the subtle one. The nautical reckonings are taken by the polar star to this day. Everybody says the polar star doesn't move. Well, it doesn't move in the circle like the other stars do, but it is slowly moving through the heavens, so slowly that the nautical reckonings are fine. They can use them. But what's interesting is that this goes back at least 5,000 years, if not closer to 6,000 years, when the polar star was in in Draco the dragon, okay? Now, with this move coming to the point where now this polar star is in the lesser sheepfold, this is an amazing change because we've gone from being in the dragon's possession to now being in the shepherd's possession because he possesses his sheepfold. So how could it have been that many thousands of years ago that they would have known and given it the name that means the turned on or the ridden? It's been turned from in the power of Satan. It will be ridden on by the King of Kings. It will be in his control. Originally, remember, we were told through Abraham's seed, the world would be blessed. Through the seed, who we know is this great shepherd, he is Cepheus the king, he is the one who's coming to rule and reign. He is the one who will give security from the enemy and victory over him. So we're seeing it as a fulfillment of Genesis 22:17, where the rest of the world would be blessed through Abraham's seed. Now it's interesting, let's look at Genesis 22:17, because we have an interesting phrase there to look at. And my tablet, there we go, I had trouble with it today too, so I know how y'all feel with your electronic problems. We're going to go to Genesis 22:17. And in Genesis 22:17, we read, and I went too far, there we go. Indeed, I will greatly bless you, and I will greatly multiply your seed as the stars of heavens and as the sand, which is on the seashore. And your seed shall possess the gate of their enemies. Okay, we've already talked about being an innumerable number. These are ones that have come to know their Lord, thank God. But to possess the gate of his enemies is to take possession of what belonged to the foe, what belonged to the enemy. The governing point of the earth's motion was the enemy's possession. but the seed of faith is telling us here, the seed shall get the enemy's gate. That means that this new one has the control now, and we with him. So what we're saying is when Messiah comes back to rule and reign, he will have the gate of his enemy. He will be able to completely destroy the enemy and bring peace over the earth.
And what verse was that in Genesis?
Genesis 22 and verse 17. And again, the lesser sheepfold or the little flock are those who have been redeemed through the ages. They belong in the safety of their shepherd, and that is what we're seeing. So, my question for you, I know we do not know God's timing perfectly. We get glimpses and we get, you know, we can begin to see. We see the signs coming of the tribulation. We know it must be near. Well, if the polar star has gone so far to go out of the dragon and to be all the way over here to the sheepfold now showing the kingdom age, the reign of Messiah, do you not think we must be awfully close to that being the actuality? I think it's just another view, and that's exciting to us. Remember, the king, Cepheus, has his foot on the polar star. He is ready to rule and to reign, and that's the picture that we are seeing here. So again, just another point that makes me believe that we are seeing how close we are to the return of our Lord. Glory, hallelujah, this will be over, and the best is yet to come. Another star that's in this sheepfold, they name it Kochab, means awaiting him who comes. There's another one that means the redeemed assembly. These are just what give us this overall view. And then also, it's been interpreted as being a traveling company. That means that think of a resting place along the road. You have traveled and you come to a resting place. Only this will be the eternal resting place. You know how we say this isn't our home, we're just traveling through, we're pilgrims on the journey? That's what we're talking about. And the star names back that up. Another one calls it the stronghold of the saved. And we know that we are waiting that eternal home that is not earthly, the same way that others before us have, as recorded in Hebrews chapter 11, and we will look at verses 13 to 16. Hebrews 11, 13 to 16. Are we good, Roger?
No. Somebody unmuted.
Okay. But the recording's going fine?
We're fine.
Okay. Hebrews 11, starting with verse 13. It's named people before this. In fact, I just glanced at 12 and I like it, so I'm going to read it to you also. Therefore, even from one man and one who was as good as dead at that, and that we're talking about Abraham, that were born descendants who were just as the stars of heaven in number and as the innumerable grains of sand along the seashore, so we know what we're talking about. We've talked about Abraham, we've talked about Jacob. Now it says, these, and it means others too, that in previously in the chapter, all these died in faith without receiving the promises. They believed it, but it didn't happen in their day. But having seen and welcomed them from a distance, having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth, for those who say such things make it clear that they are seeking a country of their own. And indeed, if they've been thinking of that country which they left, they had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to call them their God, for he has prepared a city for them. That's what we're talking about, the eternal city that has been prepared for all the redeemed through time who have not said, this is our home, we're settling here, and this is all we want. We're looking for the better, and it is coming. Hallelujah. So, because the bear, the little bear, contains a polar star, we are seeing that it represents the heavenly people of the redeemed, and they're innumerable like the stars of the heaven that we read about in Genesis 22, 17. So, with that done, looking again at Ursa Major, Zion Gadol in the Hebrew, which is Great Zion. Obviously, we know what that makes us think of here on earth today. The great bear, the bigger one, the bigger dipper in it, this one has 87 stars. It's the greater sheepfold, or they just call it the great sheepfold, the resting place of the flock. Remember, he's got two sheepfolds.
That's a bear?
Well, we talked about that last week. It doesn't really look like a bear.
No.
Bears don't have tails, but that's what they call it, so that's what we called it also. It's Job 9 and Job 38. We looked at these verses before. In fact, it's 9:9 and 38, 31, and 32 that mention the bear.
This one looks better too.
Okay, that one gives you a little better picture. It looks a little more like a bear, and you can see the dipper in it. Yeah, yeah. They took the tail away and just let the stars hang, which the stars don't need the tail. Okay, some call it the bear with her train, or the bear and her offspring. Mama bear with her cubs following her. And you know, if you're always told, if you see baby cubs, look around because mama's not far away. So, you know, we know it's our Heavenly Father, not our mother, but we know what we're saying. The ancient name is the assembled together as sheep would be assembled in a fold. The stars, one of them in the back is called Duba. That's a herd of animals or a flock. And it's actually where they give the name to the whole constellation, that the whole constellation is a flock. And then there's another star that says visited or guarded, named and numbered. Let me give you Psalm 147:4. Some of this sounds repetitive because we have some of the similarities. We see them, and it's not just in one. Psalm 147 and verse 4, he counts the number of stars. He gives names to all of them. Isaiah 40 and verse 26. Yeshaya 40 and verse 26. Isaiah 40 is a great chapter of comfort. We've talked about that recently, and it's actually perfect timing because on our Jewish calendar of reading, we were reading it in the last week. Verse 26, Isaiah 40, raise your eyes on high. See who has created these stars. The one who brings out their multitude by number, he calls them all by name. Any of you have a large family? Some of you who are privileged enough to be great grandparents, and you've got so many great greats, and you, I hear the same thing from everyone. How do I remember all of them? How do I remember all their birthdays? They might have their names down, but they're struggling to remember 63 birthdays, you know, in the family. Well, how would you like to have a multitude? And he is calling them by name. That's our God. He is amazing. Because of the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, and get our last line in verse 26, not one of them is missing.
So what verse is that?
Not
in 147?
Isaiah 40 and verse 26. Psalm 147 and verse 4 was what we did earlier. Just ahead of it. Yes.
When I was thinking of a multitude, I think of Pastor Gill and his wife. With all the
kids.
They've
only got 13 and they're struggling with 13, yeah. Okay, there's also a star in the tail called Aliot, and that means a she-goat or a mother. I see how God is our father, he's our mother in that. In the midst of the tail, it's separate or small or enclosed place. At the end of the tail, it means the daughters of the assembly. I just see how, you know, it's like the offspring going out. You've got the beginning, and then you've got the children, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, and it just goes on and on. And other stars, again, the sheepfold, the assembled. We see that it is fulfilling the sands of the sea. Can we number those? No. But is God showing us that the family is at large? Yes. That we saw, again, I'm just repeating the reference, was Genesis 22:17. But let's now look together at Ezekiel chapter 34. Ezekiel 34, verses 12 to 16. Ezekiel 34, 12. As a shepherd cares for his flock on a day when he is among his scattered sheep, so I will care for my sheep and will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a cloudy and gloomy day. Now we know this is specifically to Israel. He said he would scatter his people because of their rebellion to him, and he will regather them. We also know that we can see how the Lord has brought us as believers, the church family, the called out assembly, to be grafted in, to be a part also, that will be in this gathering and in safely. But this is specifically really talking about Israel. You'll see that in verse 13. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and bring them to their own land, the land called Israel. I will feed them on the mountains of Israel. See, it's not Michelle saying it, it's the scripture saying it. By the streams and in all the inhabited places of the land. I will feed them in good pasture, and their grazing place will be on the mountain heights of Israel. There they will lie down in a good grazing place and feed in rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. And sheep will not lie down and graze unless they feel very, very safe. They will not lie down and graze near rushing water or anything that's causing a stir. It has to be placid and still. Verse 15, I myself, God speaking, will feed my flock, and I myself will lead them to rest, declares the Lord God, Adonai Elohim. I will seek the lost, bring back the scattered, bind up the broken, strengthen the sick, but the fat and the strong, who are fat and strong apart from God, those I will eliminate. I will feed them with judgment. And we know when he returns, there is the sheep and goats judgment. The sheep go into his fold, into the, his kingdom, and the goats are cast out because they are the ones opposing him. So you can really see this come to life when you see the sheepfold here and the names of the stars. I think we're ready for Argo. Argo is the ship. Go way down on your map. Look way down. I think it's the left corner, and you will see Argo, the ship. It also means the company of travelers, which is what we've been talking about. There you go, Roger. You see it there up at the top. There you go. You're cutting it off a little bit.
That's all there is.
Oh, okay. Then the chart cut it off. I have other pictures that you'll be able to bring up, though. Okay. The ship has 64 stars. It's a ship with two galleys, as if to mention that it's got two sheepfolds.
Wow.
It's prows, and I had to learn what these words were, and I did verify them, okay? That the prow is the portion of the ship's bow that's above water. It has two prows that are above water. They are surmounted by a ram's head. The stem of one has a ram's head. The stem of the other has the fish's tail. Does that remind us of Capricorn, the goat fish, remember? The head goat, the sacrificial animal, or the ram, the sacrificial animal. The ram, the goat was being slain. The ram, we saw victory and going up. So we'll use the ram right now. And the fish, remember the fish is always a picture of redeemed people. I will make you fishers of men. So by the two bows, or the portion of the ship that's above the water, we're seeing the one who was the sacrificed animal for the people that are being redeemed. This is a very large constellation. There is a very large company of travelers. I wish we'd push it out to cover even more of the heavens. I wish more and more would come into this ship. Crowd them in. You don't need room. You don't need place to sleep. You don't need a place to eat and fix your food. You just need to be in the shelter of the fold of our God. The stars, the brightest one, it's near the keel, K-E-E-L. That's the bottommost longitudinal structural element of the vessel. So that's what, I guess, like where the ship sits on the keel into the water. And they say that on some sailboats, it has hydrodynamic and counterbalancing purposes as well. So we're going to get speed, ability to move. We're going to get what keeps it from tipping over, especially when it hits waves. When you think about it, you know, a ship with a wave should topple it, but it doesn't because of the keel. The brightest star in there is known as Canopus, C-A-N-O, P as in Peter, U-S. Now, when I say the next word, listen to my spelling and don't jump and go somewhere. It's also called cannabis, okay? C-A-N-A-B-U-S, B-U-S, okay? A very close word to something we're familiar with today. I'm not even going there. I'll give it to you in Hebrew, Yarosh, okay? And I may be not pronouncing any of these words right. I am not trained. Anciently, it was known as, I'm making an attempt. Anciently, it was known as Zion. It's known as the helmsman or the possession of him who comes. So all this company of travelers that are on this ship, we are the possession of him who comes. Now, let me tell you about this brightest star. We'll call it Canopus, okay? This is 313 light years from Earth. Okay, so if we could go the speed of light for 313 years, we will come to Canopus.
Wow.
It burns brighter than Sirius, and I told you how bright Sirius was last week. It blazes with a brilliance of 17,000 of our cents.
Wow.
So if you took 1 cent, 2 cents, 3 cents, you got 17,000. That's how bright campus is. And I see Dora over there shaking her head like me, like, I can't contain this. I can't fathom this. I can't understand it. If cannabis was closer, remember Sirius is only 8.3 light years from Earth, only I say. 186,000 miles per second times 8.3 years. Well, go 313 light years, go to cannabis, but if it was as close as Sirius is for us, it would outshine the entire sky. It would outshine everything in the sky. It would take 65 of our suns stretched across to span the diameter of campus. 65 of our suns, just to get to the diameter. Now, I have a minute to minute and a half video. I've asked Roger to call it up. It's the first one that I sent to you. And in this, it's in the middle, all together is 4.5 minutes. We're only going to look at the last minute and a half. You will see many names go by that are names that we've been mentioning in this study. But just realize when you see, you know, what size they're showing us, because they did it in perspective, it just begins to no, it doesn't. But I don't begin to understand. It's just amazing, okay? Let your mind be blown away. And if I believe everybody at home will be able to see it in a moment. Also, if not, I can send you the address to go see it on your own or to watch the full length on your own also. It's just, it's an amazing little snippet.
It is called the biggest stars.
The biggest stars in the universe is the name of it. Yes, wow. Yeah, and that's why we just keyed it up to where we're talking about. You'll notice in all this, the biggest that they even show, they can't get campus in here because it's too big. Oh, you started at the beginning. You were supposed to start where it was keyed up.
Huh?
You were supposed to start where it was keyed up. It was keyed right at the 3 minute something.
Oh,
If you need to, I think maybe we're doing okay on time. I don't remember where in three. It was a keyed up. I gave you the code, and the code took you right to it. You went back to the beginning. Okay. Can you call it up again and just go to where it is?
Yeah.
My only concern is I want to finish our class. If I know we're going to do okay, I would tell us. And if it's going to be too hard, we'll just look at the...
No, we'll be
hard. Okay. If it doesn't, if it starts over again this time, probably it's where that line is. Unless that line was you. Okay. Yeah. Okay, it's going back to the beginning. Just let it go. Just let it go. It's going to be a little longer than folks. We'll trust the Lord on time. Go ahead and just let it go.
Oh, I got to get back.
Oh, sorry. I probably wasted more time trying to get you on point. But it worked for me.
I think when you sent it, it just reset itself.
Huh. It doesn't for me because I do the same thing to me that I do to you. But anyway. Oh. Just bring it up and we'll all enjoy it. Okay, here we go. Can you see?
That's the beginning, I guess.
Yeah. Can you see?
Thank you.
Does that begin to give you an idea the size? When you see that little dot, that's Earth, and then when you see it say that it take 1,100 years to circle around one of those others, and it just gets bigger and bigger. We really cannot fathom, we cannot measure, and we cannot understand the heavens. But do they not declare the glory of God, the colors, the designs? And then when you see this orderliness that I've been able to bring you, where the stars are in order, where they tell the story, where they, when they've moved, it's for a purpose and a reason, and all that it shows, how could there not be a master designer keeping it in control? How could this be an evolutionary matter that came out of nothing and suddenly came together, took shape, and kept order, when look at man, who does nothing but disorder his little space that he has? This is our God. This is how great our God is. This is what I want you to see and capture, and then realize he's looking past all of that, and he's calling them by names. He knows their names, but he's looking past that when he comes and he looks upon you. And he works in the split second timing of your life.
I never dreamed.
I got a little bit over here going, wow, I never dreamed. Wow. Yeah, none of us can dream this big. But I want you to catch that. How amazing, how awesome. And that's the powerful God that we can count on taking care of us. That gives us that faith to believe that whatever we're facing, our problem is minuscule to a God who can create that and keep it in that kind of order and that kind of precise, detailed plan set in motion that we only know about 6,000 years. We don't know before and we don't know after. And yet, it's exactly how he said. God said in Scripture that Messiah would come in the fullness of time. And it came exactly when it said, sent on a decree at 445 BC that if our people had paid attention to their prophecies, they could have counted down. And as Adrian Rogers said, book the hotels and line the streets for Messiah's coming in exactly when it said that he would. And he did. And that great prophecy says he would be cut off violently, crucifixion. But that prophecy also takes us all the way to the end, that millennial reign, that return of the one who was cut off, who comes back in all his glory. Now, take it to the glory and think how bright these stars are, how amazing that our eyes couldn't even comprehend, and the colors are because of the heat and all of that, and now have the Son of Man coming in all his glory, where it's seen around the world, where it... The stars are dark, the sun isn't shining, because the glory of God is being seen.
So the heaven, where's heaven at? Past all that?
That's in the heavens. But God's heaven, where he is,
that's
you mean, is above all of that. Wow. We cannot get to where God's heaven is by our measurements. We can't. We know there's more heavens, but we can't get there.
Wow.
On our own. We get there in the power of the Lord. Patty,
when it's time. People think that all of this came from a big boom, an amoeba floating.
And where did the amoeba come from? And how did it come together precisely at the right moment and split into male and female that were together at the same time, that had the balance of everything else that had to be able to form into a form of life that continues? I
we
give
have
you
an awesome God.
Exactly.
We
I give you
awesome
my
God.
Awesome, ineffable, indescribable God. And
ultimate, intimate,
yes, and keep trying. There you go.
Okay. just a quick question. I'm sorry to take us back, but I want to snag it before we get too far. In Urso Major, could I, with the references, I have Isaiah 6:40. I don't think that's right.
No, 40 verse 26. Isaiah 40 verse 26.
And Psalm 147:4.
Correct.
Genesis 22:17.
Yes.
Ezekiel 34 verses 12 through 16.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Rochelle.
Sure.
Appreciate it.
Sure.
What about
Job? And Job, where it names the bear and other, it talks about some other of the constellations. Job, chapter 9, verse 9. and chapter 38, verses 31 and 32. Because I've read those before, I didn't read them today to save us a moment of time, because I really want us to get all the way to the end, see it all together. Anyone who is interested in a link to that, you've got the name of it, but I've got the link, gladly will share it also. I can send it to you in whatever format you need, just let me know. But again, it is just mind-blowing. I think the overall is the 25 brightest stars in the sky that it covers. Amazing. That's what we know right now and what we can snap a picture of right now.
And there's
now.
More.
And there's more. There's more. Okay, other stars in this also, in this ship, in Argo, are Sethina, which means the multitude or abundance. Again, a lot of people. I'm thrilled to hear that. Tereus or Therese, I don't know how to say it, the possession, means that we are firmly in his hand. He is possessing us. Nothing's going to take us from him. Another name I can't even pronounce means the release to travel. I love that. When we're released from gravity on this earth, we're going to travel. And I have news for you, I'm not going in any ship or a plane or anything else. We are just going to soar. I'd love to just go take an eyeball look at Betelgeuse, Sirius, Canopus, these that we've been saying. Just look at them and just stand in awe. Hanging in space, you know, not standing on the ground, hanging in space in awe at
like
the majesty
Superman.
Of our God. Yeah. There is another name and of another star that means the desired. We are his desired. He desires us. And the Hebrew means the desired promise of the oath taker. God has taken an oath, and we know that. He swore by himself because there was no one greater to swear by. We see in that. That we are his desire, and he keeps his promise. He said he would save us. There's one final star that is also called the branch, and we know that's a name for the Messiah. Let me read to you Isaiah again, Isaiah chapter 60, Yeshaya 60, that's 6-0. And I'm going to read to you verses 4 and 5 and 8 and 9. Read it all later for yourself. But chapter 60, Isaiah 4 and 5 and 8 and 9 says, raise your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons will come from afar. Your daughters will be carried on the hip. Then you will see and be radiant, and your heart will thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea will be turned to you. The wealth of the nations will come to you. At that same time, verse 8, who are these who fly like a cloud and like the doves to their windows? Certainly the coastlands will wait for me, and the ships of Tarshish will come first to bring your sons from afar. Their silver and their gold with them for the name of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, because he has glorified you. When God glorifies Israel, it's by putting his son ruling and reigning on this earth in his messiahship. And when that happens and he is Messiah on earth, the kingdom of heaven on earth, they're even going to come by ship, returning to the land of Israel. Interesting that this is a ship called Argo. It again is a picture of the redeemed pilgrims safely arriving at home. And they're arriving at home not empty-handed, but with the lost treasure regained. What was lost because Satan got us in his grip, the Lord has regained. We are his people. He will have a heavenly people, and he will have an earthly people, because the millennium will go on with earthly people who will worship him and praise him. It is a beautiful picture. And that is the finish of our Cancer. I'm going to call it the scarab rather than the crab. Nothing crabby about it. Okay. We're ready to go into our 12th constellation now. The last one, believe it or not, called Leo the Lion. In ancient, in the Egyptian, in the Indian, in the Oriental zodiacs, all of these, it is the end of the circle called the zodiac. Okay? Today they do a different, they start, several of them start in different places, but they don't start and end as it did then. We'll talk about why we do where we do when we tie this up. We said it in the beginning, but at the end we'll say it again. To give you a description of Leo, there are 95 stars. Leo the Lion, and you see him upside down here, but that's Leo the Lion, number 12, He is treading upon the serpent. That squiggly line below, that's the serpent. Yeah, all of that, and go all the way over toward the, yeah, the crater, because crater is going to be one of the three decons underneath. And also, you just showed the other one, Corvus, the bird. Yeah, there, that's on the serpent also. That whole line is the serpent. That's called Hydra. We've talked about Hydra, but we've not looked and studied Hydra. We will talk and look and study Hydra and its end in this constellation also. But first, we've got the lion of the tribe of Judah. Does that not remind you of Revelation 5 and verse 5? It should. Revelation 5 and verse 5 says, "And one of the elders said to me, stop weeping. Behold, the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome so as to be able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Remember, this is when the Yochanan had seen the heavenly scene. There needed to be someone who could open the scroll. The only one who could open the scroll is the one who is the owner of the scroll. The scroll ends up being the grant deed to the earth, and it looked like no one, no angel, no human in heaven or in the earth or under the earth, no one could open it. But when he was ready to be overcome with grief that it could not be opened, he's told, don't cry. There is one who can. The one who owns it, the one who has purchased it with his blood, this is the one who is able to break open the seals and show his ownership, and he is the lion of the tribe of Judah. In our picture, he is the lion that is aroused for the rending of the prey. He's ready to tear his prey apart. It shows he's ready to descend upon its head. Here, Roger's righted it up now. So we have Leo on top, and you can see that he looks like he's ready to pounce on the head of Hydra. And when he pounces on that head, he's going to crush that head. What messianic reference does that make you think of? We've said it probably 100 times in this study. Crushing the head, the death blow.
Of the serpent.
Of the serpent.
Mm-hmm.
How about if we go all the way to the beginning, the very first prophecy, yeah, Genesis 3:15, where it said that the serpent, Hydra, would crush his heel where he touched the earth in his human form, and we see the crucifixion, but he would crush his head. You crush the head, it's dead. This is a death blow. Genesis 3, verse 15. The reference I've given time and time again in our study. But notice also now, you can, in fact, we'll read Genesis 3:15 because we want to go to Genesis 49. So just go all the way back to 3 first, and then we'll flip to chapter 49. Genesis 3:15, because this is so important. In the very first prophecy given to Adam, given to Eve, in the very beginning when they had sinned, this promise is given. So at the beginning of what we know of the time of man, all the way through, and we see it fulfilled. In the fulfillment of time, the perfect timing, God will see to it. And that gives us proof of all the other prophecies in between. Verse 15, "And I will make enemies of you," he's talking about Satan, "and the woman that he caused to be deceived, to fall from being obedient to the Lord, who brought sin into the world along with her mate, Adam." And it says, "And of your offspring and her descendant." Okay, so Satan actually doesn't give birth to offspring, but he's got his henchmen doing his duties all the way to the Antichrist in the end. But there's going to be enmity all the way through, and her descendant, her seed, singular. We know from Galatians 3:16, the seed is spelled out to be Yeshua, Jesus. He will bruise you on the head. You'll bruise him on the heel. All you can do is manage to bruise him on the heel. You think you're getting a victory. That crucifixion actually is the greatest victory for all of us, because through his death and life again, we come into that new promised life for us. So no victory for Satan at all, but this is the complete fulfillment of it. Now, in chapter 49, Jacob, it thinks he's about to die, and he's giving prophecy over his 12 sons. This is very Jewish what they do, and it would be words that were spoken prophetically by the Spirit of God that would be true over the sons, and we will see them through the scriptures, some already that we see and some still to be fulfilled.
What verse was that? Jen says 49, what?
49, we're going to look at verses 8 and 9, because this is what has to do with Judah and the lion. Okay, verse 8, as for you, Judah, your brothers shall praise you, your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies, your father's sons will bow down to you. Now, here's verse 9, Judah is like a lion's cub, from the prey, my son, you've gone up, he crouches, he lies down as a lion, and is a lion who dares to stir him up. What we see is the stages of a lion's life in here. If I took you into the Hebrew and gave you the words in the Hebrew, what we have in our English is it starts out with lion's whelp, W-H-E-L-P. A lion's whelp is a pup. What do you call a baby lion?
A cub.
Cub? Okay. I know they're a pride. But anyway, you have the birth of the baby lion. We'll call it that, okay? In that, we see the birth in human form of Messiah, okay? Then you have him stooped down. When he was stooped down in his humility, he was made low, lower than the angels. Hebrews 1 tells us that's his crucifixion. That's the cross that we're seeing in view there. Then he crouches as a lion. When that lion is crouching, he is ready to come against his enemy. We see the lion coming to judge the enemy. Okay, so we begin to see his return here, which we see culminated in that he lies down as a lion. This is an old lion, not old and worn out, but he now has hit that kingly state. He is now king of the jungle, and he's resting in his glory that everything is subdued under him. This is the Lord seated on his throne, ruling as king. The lion's king of the jungle. All the other lions know he is head king. That's what we're seeing here. So we see everything from his birth to the crucifixion to his coming back as judge, annihilating the enemy, and in a peaceful repose, ruling as king. That's what we see in Leo the lion. His Hebrew name means the lion who rants, Aria, the lion who rants, or a strong lion hunting down his prey. When he returns, and remember this book is talking about his return in his second coming to consummate his triumph and to get his those that he redeemed. This is the strong lion hunting down the enemy, getting rid of the enemy, the prey. The enemy is his prey. There are six Hebrew words for lion. Again, the lion hunting down his prey, the lion's whelp, the lion the first time he hunts for himself, the mature lion in full strength, the fierce lion. There's even the word for a lioness, the female lion. And then finally, the adult lion who is in search of his prey, but once he has pierced his prey, once he has devoured his prey, now he gains his bride. When the lion does his final battle that he's the king over even all the other male lions, that's when he gets all the girls, the one he'll mate with anyway. But it's all his. It's all his choice. We see that our Lion of the Tribe of Judah will take out all the enemy, and there will be none left to fight him, and we will be his bride. In the following star names, we see the Lion of the Tribe of Judah rising up for judgment. That also is seen in Numbers, Bamidbar, Numbers 24. Verses 8 and 9. Numbers 24, verses 8 and 9. Here we read, God brings him out of Egypt. He is for him like the horns of the wild ox. He will devour the nations who are his adversaries. He will crush their bones. He will smash them with arrows. He crouches. He lies down like a lion and like a lioness who dares to rouse him. Blessed is everyone who blesses you, and cursed is everyone who curses you. No one is going to fool with the king of the jungle. This is, again, Revelation 5 and verse 5, where we see, and I want to back up. I'm going to take us back to Revelation 5 because I want us to see the two stages here. I lost my train of thought because I had trouble with my tablet. Sorry. What I want us to see is, we already read verse 5 where it's the Lion of the Tribe of Judah who is able to open the scroll and it shows his power. But verse 6, remember I saw between the throne with the four living creatures and the elders, a lamb standing as if slaughtered, having seven horns, seven eyes. It goes on describing, but what we're seeing is the lamb that looked as if he'd been slaughtered, now that newness is alive, and now we see him as the lion, who is worthy of our praise, who is king of the jungle. I wish you could see my poster, because it's Lion of Judah, Lamb of God, and that's what we're seeing, that victory that is theirs. The other stars in here, the lion, the names mean the rending lion, a lion that comes vehemently to tear and lay waste. The brightest star is when you see, you can see the elliptical path again, and you see the bright star just above the ecliptic, it actually would be on it. That marks the heart of the lion. It's called Cor Leonis, the heart of the lion. The ancient name is Regalus, R-E-G-A-L-U-S, which means either treading underfoot, which again shows us he's treading the enemies under his feet, he's victorious, or some say that Regalus means the scepter and the rulership. And remember, the scepter would not leave Judah before the king had come. We know that the king coming out of the tribe of Judah is the lion of the tribe of Judah, is Messiah himself.
If the lion turns sideways, looks like the legs are coming out, and it looks like the tail comes up like this.
If the tail's over at the end, you've got four legs that are the lower part of this, and then the head's over here. Okay.
You're talking about these two legs here. These two here.
Okay. But she's talking about in the other picture, what she's trying to see
the stars.
It. In the stars.
Which picture? Like the tails.
This one? Look,
yes.
Like a horse.
Okay. Okay, take your pen and mark the head is on the right. There okay. You go. That's the head. And then the four legs, see the four legs?
Yeah.
There you go. There you go. Those are the four legs. Okay? Remember, they're not exacting pictures. It's not that the Lord drew an exact line in the sky.
Yeah,
it's just what they've brought around.
Yeah.
There you go. You can see it a little bit later.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the rocking horse. But
it's like a horse.
But it's a lion, okay? But what we're seeing is Messiah's rule. We're seeing he is a rightful ruler. We're seeing him in his kingly role. The star in the tip of his tail means the judge. And it also means the Lord who comes with haste. Revelation 22. Sometimes I think we forget that you know, it's long in his coming, but when he comes fast. Okay? Revelation 22 and verse 7. He says, "And behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book." That's the last chapter in our Bible. Verse 20. "He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." That amen is Yochanan, John responding. He's just been told by the Lord, yes, I'm coming quickly. And John's saying, do it, Lord, do it. Even so, do it. That's what he's saying. And I think that's where we all live right now. How many of us want to say, come on, Lord, do it, do it, do it? If you're watching the Olympics.
Chapter?
That was, yeah, chapter 22, verses 7 and 20. The last chapter of our entire Bible.
Okay.
If you're watching the Olympics now, and you see the race is on, and you're pushing for them to get to the end, you know, make that final move. That's what we're waiting for. The stars can also mean from their names that he executes judgment and he punishes. Because when he does come, he will come to punish the enemy. He will come to do away with those who have been his enemy and been against him all along. And he will show himself to be the one to be reckoned with. I'm trying to call up Ezekiel chapter 7 and verse 3. "Now the end is upon you, for I will send my anger against you." We know that comes in the tribulation, that the anger poured out on a sin-soaked world. "I will judge you according to your ways and bring all your abominations, all your idolatry upon you." Ezekiel 7:3. You don't want to be on that side of our great God. You want to be on the side that you're in his victory team with him. Yochanan, John chapter 5 and verse 22. John 5, verse 22. Verse 22, chapter 5, "For not even the Father judges anyone, but he's given all judgment to the Son." The Father could judge, but he has given it to the Son, who has the right to judge because he took on human form. And so he knows the human life, and he has the right to judge it and to call it out. The star in the mane of the animal means the exaltation. This is his being exalted. Every knee will bow. Philippians chapter 2, the earlier part tells us that he humbled himself unto death, even the death of the cross. Now, we're going to start with verse 6, Philippians 2 and verse 6. Who, as he already existed in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Here we go. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a bondservant. He emptied himself from all that he was in heaven to take on that human form. He confined himself. How does God confine himself? Blows my mind, but he did. Took on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man, being found in the appearance of man. He even humbled himself to the point of becoming obedient, to the point of death, death on the cross. For this reason also God highly exalted him. He was made a little lower than the angels for a time, and then he is brought up in exaltation above all. God has highly exalted him, verse 9, bestowed on him the name which is above every name. So at the name of Yeshua Jesus, every knee will bow, of those in heaven, those on earth, and even those under the earth, those who have their earthly bodies have died. And every tongue will confess that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, is Adonai, Lord, to the glory of Elohim, Jehovah, God the Father. Wow. That's victory. That's do his holy name, and I can't wait to see that happen. I love it. The mane of the animal is to make him look like a king. If we're talking male, it would be a queen if we were talking female, but because to me it's a picture of our Lord, I'm going to go with the king. The hinder part of his back has a star that says shining forth. In Hebrew, is okay, kumi ori. Now, or is light, but ori is shine. It's a light that shines, okay? Kumi ori. Let me just give it to you this way. Go with me to Isaiah 60. Isaiah chapter 60. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. It goes on and talks about how they were in darkness and they've seen a great light. Who is the one who arise and shines? The Lord. And brought his glory to Israel, to all who would believe in him.
What verse is that?
That was Isaiah chapter 60, just verse 1. But you can keep on reading because verse 2, behold, darkness will cover the earth, deep darkness the peoples, but the Lord will rise upon you. His glory will appear upon you. Nations will come to your light. Kings to the brightness of your rising. This is his return and second coming in all his glory, and the world will see it. I realize I skipped a verse earlier to Halim, Psalm 21:13. Let's take a quick peek at that. I honestly don't remember, but I've got it in my notes. Yeah. Psalm 21:13. Oh, be exalted, Lord, in your strength. We will sing and praise your power. When we see him as this exalted one, when we talked about it, every knee bowing, that's where Psalm 21, verse 13, that the Lord will be exalted in all his strength, and we will be singing and praising his power. That's shouting our hallelujahs, singing unto him. All will be rejoicing over him being now in that glorious position. There's a star that we can't see. One of the unidentified ones in here means the joining, and that's the key one. To the students who studied these zodiacs from the past all the way through, they believe that that star called the joining is intimating where the two points or the two ends of the zodiac circle have their joining. Remember, we're looking at a circle. The circle we say has no beginning and end, but this one does. We have to jump in there and study somewhere. And as I said, today's astrology does not start where God's astronomy starts. But this joining, what we're seeing in this star, is starting with Virgo and ending with Leo. We start with the Virgin who brings forth the Son, and we end with that Son being not in his humility, but in his glory, returned, ruling, and reigning. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. Hold on to that, and you'll see what I'm talking about. Bring out one point for it when it's time. There's another star that means the punishing or the tearing of the lion. That doesn't mean that the lion's torn, but he's going to tear his prey. We're going to see that in the coming decons that we'll be looking at in just a moment. There's another star called the Judge Comes Who Seizes. When he's seizing, he's taking control. If you seize your enemy, you've got the power over your enemy. So if we put all of this together out of Leo the lion, we have the glory of God. We saw that in Isaiah 60. We have that he's like a consuming fire. That's Hebrews 12:29. He comes to judge against the wicked. That's 2 Thessalonians 2:8. He's going to take out the Antichrist and all who believed his lie when he returns in that second coming. If you look with me, let's see, where are we on time? If I got time. I think I can look up the verses quickly. Let's just look at them real quickly to get that full picture, okay? Hebrews 12:29, again, this is what I just said. This is where he's judging when he comes. Hebrews 12:29, we don't want to be on that side. You don't want to be judged by the lion when he comes. You want to be part of his team coming back with him. Hebrews 12 and verse 29, we read, for our God is a consuming fire. Remember the fire? And the fire, the river went all the way down into the lake of fire. That's what it's talking about. He will consume his enemy like fire, that fire of judgment. He will judge the wicked. 2 Thessalonians 2:8. 2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 8. Verse 8 of chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians, we read, then the lawless one will be revealed. That's the Antichrist, whom the Lord, and I just lost my place, sorry, whom the Lord will eliminate with the breath of his mouth and bring to an end by the appearance of his coming. He shows up, and Antichrist is Krispy Kreme. He's done, he's gone, he's cast into the lake of fire. For those who like those donuts, sorry, it's not a treat, and it's not something good. This is the ashes that are left from a fire that consumes. Go with me to Revelation 20. We're going to look, Revelation 20 is a chapter on the millennium, but we're going to look at the end of the millennium on that other side. We're going to start with verse 10. Revelation 20 and verse 10. Are you ready to say a hallelujah? And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are also, and they'll be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I do say, hallelujah. The one who has tormented us, who has been our enemy, who has tried to keep people from coming to the love of the Lord who made them and wants them with him, this one will finally be put in his place, the lake of fire, which was made for him, by the way. Matthew 25, verse 41 says that hell was made for the devil and his angels. This is what we're reading here. Also, at the same time, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat upon it. This is verse 11. From whose presence earth and heaven fled, and no place was found for them. I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne. The books were opened. Notice it's the dead standing before the Lord. This is the great white throne judgment. If they're dead, they're dead in their sins from the beginning of time all the way through to whenever this finally takes place. It's all who have lived through their lifetime, never accepted the Lord as their Savior. They're now going to stand in their own sin, and they are judged for the things that they've done. They are judged. The book of life is open. That's verse 12. The books are open. The book of life. The dead were judged from the things that were written in the books according to their deeds. The sea gives up the dead in it. Death and Hades give up the dead in them. They're judged, each one of them, according to their deeds. Again, they're not judged according to what someone else did. It's on them. Each one is responsible for themselves. Whether you reject or whether you accept Messiah, it's on you. You can't put that off anybody else. No one can do it for you. They can't force you. They can't. Everyone's responsible for themselves. And so they're standing there. They're responsible, and God looks at their life so that someone who lived a horrible life like a Hitler gets a far worse punishment than someone who was a sweet little old lady but still was an enemy of our Lord, never accepted him, rejected him. God gives the light, and if they reject, they are choosing to place themselves in an eternal separation from God. It was never his choice. It is what they have chosen because he will not force himself on anyone.
That was Matthew what?
We're reading Revelation 20.
Oh.
Revelation 20, verses 10 to 15.
Oh.
Verse 14 says, death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. Anyone's name not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. How do you get your name written in a book of life? It's by accepting the Lord into your heart. That's all you have to do. Back to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. And in Hebrews 2:14, we read, therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same. Because we're flesh and blood, the Redeemer had to be like us to rescue us. He took on flesh and blood, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. So the devil's going to be done away with, death is going to be done away with, sin is going to be done away with. It's all done, it's all gone, it's all removed forever and ever and ever and ever. Can I hear it?
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Is that Hebrews what?
Hebrews 2 and verse 14. The judgment is swift. The judgment is final. This is the grand finale. This is the final act. Sin doesn't ever come back again. There's no history repeats itself. There's no starting all over again. So the lion, by the time we see him ready to rend his prey, we see him speaking of judgment. That takes us to the book called Amos. You call it Amos. It's a little, one of the little prophets. Might be hard for you to find. We're going to look at, we're going to look at chapter 1. And if I keep mistyping, that'll give you a chance to find it. Amos chapter 1. Amos. Amos in our Hebrew. Amos chapter 1, verse 2. And he said, the Lord roars from Zion. Who roars? Lions roar. Here's him being seen as the lion. The Lord roars from Zion. From Jerusalem he utters his voice. The shepherd's pasture grounds mourn. The summit of Carmel dries up. They would stand in fear at this roar. You ever heard the king of the jungle roar and everybody shakes? That's what we're talking about. This is what the Lord says, verse 3. For three offenses at Damascus and for four, I will not revoke its punishment because they threshed Gilead with iron sledges. What that does is that just gives us a picture of the judgment, what they've done. They will reap the consequences of it.
What chapter was that?
That was chapter 1. I read verses 2 and 3. 2 is the most important one there. Now we'll go to chapter 3 of Amos. Just flip over to chapter 3 of Amos, and I will read verses 4 and 8. 4 says, does a lion roar in the forest when he has no prey? Does a young lion growl from his den unless he has captured something? We know the answer to those questions. Verse 8, a lion has roared. Who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken. Who can do anything but prophesy? You can try as much as you want, but all you can do is declare the truth of the Lord. Even those who are opposed to him in the end will bow their knee before him and declare he is God. And they should have bowed before him. Hosea chapter 13, verses 7 and 8. Very close to Amos, if you're there, you'll find it quickly. Hosea, Joel, Amos, go back just a couple books. And Hosea chapter 13, close to the end of Hosea, verses 7 and 8. So I will be like a lion to them. Like a leopard, I will wait by the wayside. I will confront them like a bear deprived of her cubs and will tear open their chests. I will devour them there like a lioness, as a wild animal would tear them to pieces. He's saying, I am going to be like the mama bear. I'm going to be like the lion that somebody came against her little cubs, whatever we're supposed to call them. He is going to come against what has come against those that are his. And he will take them out. If you've ever even seen a mama hen, don't get between mama hen and her babies. This is our Lord. We're under his wing. And those, when he returns.
So Amos was what chapter?
Amos chapter 1, verse 2. And Amos chapter 3, verses 4 and 8.
And now, what's the one now?
Hosea.
Hosea.
13, 7 and 8. Okay, now this is interesting. Each year, every year, usually in November, is what's called a Leonid, Leo, N-I-D, okay, Leo, Leonid, I don't know how to say it, meteor shower. On rare occasions, they'll call it a meteor storm. A storm is among the 10 rarest and most amazing astronomical events. It doesn't mean only 10 have happened, but they rate them. And when it's a meteor storm, it's so many of these stars that are falling and that are moving that it's one of the 10 most powerful signs in the heavens, okay? Every year, there's a Leonid meteor shower. The epicenter, the origin of this meteor shower comes from the mouth of the lion. That's why it's called Leonid, okay? Why they give it that name. Makes us think of the scripture that says, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. In other words, when the Lord says it, believe it. He's roaring. He's speaking what he says will happen. Let me show you in scripture, Isaiah 1:20. Yeshaya, Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 20. We're going to read just several of them real quick. Isaiah 1, verse 20. But if you refuse and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Period. Okay, I'll put a period there. Go to chapter 40 and verse 5. Remember, the 40 is the comfort chapter because God is going to take care of his people. Verse 5, then the glory of the Lord will be revealed. All flesh will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This glory of the Lord coming that we're talking about, the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Is it going to happen? Yes. Can you take it to the bank?
Yes.
Yes. Take it to the bank of God and cash it out and see it for all it's worth. God said it. It will happen. Chapter 58, verse 14. This isn't a hope-so faith that we have. This is a know-so. We know what God says he will do. Proof of the pudding is all the prophecy that's been fulfilled in the past. Everything up to date, perfectly fulfilled. Why would you doubt the last little bit? Wouldn't come true exactly how God says also.
So 58 what?
58 and verse 14. 58:14, then you will take delight in the Lord. I will make you ride on the heights of the earth. I'll feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father. Here's the blessings that will come to Israel. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Period. God's not done with Israel. She will come into that glory that God has promised her, yes, with her Messiah sitting on the throne. High and lifted up. Revelation 19, 15. Battle of Armageddon's been going on. It is the end of this battle. It is the Lord returning in that glory. And verse 15 says, and I love it because it's the Hallelujah chapter, and I love Hallelujah. From his mouth comes a sharp sword so that with it he may strike down the nations. He will rule them with a rod of iron. He treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. Did you notice from his mouth comes a sharp sword? The mouth of the Lord has spoken.
That's the word.
That's the word. That is the word, and it is the official, the complete word. Don't take from it. Don't take away from it. Don't add to it. It is complete. Now, let me give you an example of this meteor storm. In 1833, on November 13th, it seemed, and I'm reading a quote here, it seemed as if the whole starry heavens had congregated as one point near the zenith and were simultaneously shooting forth, just choom, 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 all these meteor showers to the point of being a storm, with the velocity of lightning to every part of the horizon, and yet they were not exhausted. Thousands swiftly followed in the track of thousands as if created for the occasion, testified an onlooker. Never did rain fall much thicker than the meteors fell toward the earth. East, west, north, south, it was the same, said another. In a word, the whole heavens seemed in motion. That was one of these meteor storms that was seen. Okay? Now, since 1833, they've begun to understand things like Halley's Comet. You know, all of this has happened. Okay? They say, even with the knowledge that they've gained, the Leonids, these meteor storms or showers, have had a major effect on the development of the scientific study of meteors and what was previously thought about their phenomena. They've given more understanding, okay? Here's again what a modern day, on the basis of what they learned from these says. It's truly superlative strength. super strength, super power. One estimate is over 100,000 meteors an hour, but another done as the storm abated said that they estimated 240,000 meters during the 9 hours of storm that covered the entire region of North America east of the Rockies. That was wow. just one time of these meteor showers, okay?
Was anybody hurt?
They didn't say. I think not, because I think it was just up in the heavens. But on the basis of believing that the end was coming, when they saw that, they thought the end was coming, the Cheyenne tribe established a peace treaty, the Lakota tribe reset their calendar, and others, you know, thought that this was it. There have been repeats of the Lena falling stars, but none as spectacular as 1833 and 1868, the two that I've just described, where so many fell. Some say even 3,000 meteors per hour falling in the sky. What am I bringing out? Let's read a little bit of scripture. Let's go to Hebrews 1, 11 and 12, besides obviously showing you the power of our God. He put him in space, he flung him in space, and he can send him out when he wants also. Hebrews 1 and verse 11. Can we jump in there? Let me start with 10. You, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth. The heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish. The heavens and the earth, that's going to perish, but you, Lord, you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like a robe, you will roll them up like a garment. They are also that also will be changed, but you are the same, and your years will not come to an end. He can roll up the sky, and we're going to read in Revelation where it does sound like the stars are rolled up, that the scroll that he unrolled and showed us time, it's over now. So he's rolled it up, and the stars fell out, and we'll see what stars fall also. Look with me at Revelation 6. We are ready to go there right now. I should have just read my notes instead of trying to explain. Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 through 14. Revelation 6, verse 12. And I looked when he broke the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. Here comes the evidences in the heavens, okay? The sun became black as sackcloth, made of hair. The whole moon became like blood. The stars of the sky fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its unripe figs when shaken by a great wind. You ever shaken a tree and all the fruit's falling? That's what it looked like with the stars falling. The sky was split apart like a scroll when it's rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. That is power. That is our God. He not only made them, put them in space in this order, but when he wants, he will roll up the scroll and the stars fall. Look at Isaiah, Yeshaya chapter 34 and verse 3. And remind me to bring out a thought to you if I don't about why I think the scroll was rolled up.
Was that Revelation?
That was Revelation 6, and now we're in Isaiah 34 and verse 4. And all the heavenly lights will wear away. The sky will be rolled up like a scroll. Its lights will also wither away as a leaf withers from the vine, or as one withers from the fig tree. So we do see it prophesied that the sky does have, it's no wonder they thought the end was coming. That was a foretaste. There is a greater coming in Revelation 6 when it does happen, and when we come to the end also.
Revelation 19.
Isaiah chapter 34 and verse 4. Okay, let's look real quick at our three constellations so we can finish on time. By the way, I'm thinking that the scroll may be rolled up because we've come to the end of the story it tells, and maybe God's going to unroll a new now. I don't know. Maybe he's going to do something totally different. All I know is my God is greater than anything I can think. Okay, Hydra, our first decon or constellation, means the serpent. Revelation 12:9 gives us the name, and it gives us no room to doubt. Revelation 12 and verse 9. If you want to know who it is, just read this verse. And the great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil, and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Okay, if you call him the great dragon, if you call him the serpent, if you call him the devil, if you call him the Satan, if you call him the deceiver, the one that was thrown down to the earth, we've just described him. We know who he is. Hydra is going to be cast down.
And what
down.
Verse was that?
Revelation 12, verse 9. Now, stay in 12 for a minute. It's very interesting. The hydra that Roger's got on the bottom of our screen here, the chart picture, the hydra, the stretch, he stretches, okay? The serpent stretches across a third of the way across the whole sphere that we look at, okay? Our sky that we look at, hydra is one third of the way around. Notice verse 4 of chapter 12. His tail, speaking of the dragon, his tail swept away a third of the stars of heaven and hurled them to the earth. I wonder if that's why he's a third of the space of heaven. Mm-hmm. Just as an example, a third of the stars, which was the angels, went with them, fell with them. Can you imagine that? A third wanted Satan to be their God. Well, the old serpent is destroyed. We have a picture of a female serpent. Don't ask me how. I do not know, but I'm just told from my notes. It's like saying she's the mother or the author of all evil. I hear Saddam Hussein, you know, the mother of all wars, the mother of this, the mother of that, okay? I'll use it in that way. The name means he is abhorred. Do you abhor him? I abhor the serpent. I abhor Hydra. The brightest star in the heart of the serpent, you see it close to the ship there, you know, the sail part of the ship. Mm-hmm. That is the heart of the serpent. It means the separated, put out of the way. This is where, again, where we're told in Matthew 25:41 that the lake of fire was made for the devil and his angels. They're put away, they're put out of the way, they are separated from us forever and ever and ever. The heart of the serpent, again, that's the only place that he's got life, because he's got a heart, and it's his death, his doom. There's another star, again, abhorred, and then there's another star that means the tearing to pieces or the piercing of the deceiver. Remember we said Leo was ready to pierce, and when he pierces, then he's won, he's conquered, he's king of the jungle, and he gets his bride, okay? So that's what we're seeing. We're going to see how that's happening by looking at the second decon. The second decon is called Crater. Crater is that cup. Roger was right on it. It's that cup. It's the cup of divine wrath poured out on Satan, on Hydra, and actually all that belong to him. That cup that's being poured out is called the cup of his, meaning God's, of his indignation, of his wrath. Look with me. I'm going to go through some scriptures quickly. If you don't get all the references, I'll give them to you in person later, because I want to move. I don't want to run out of time. We're too close to the end. Psalm 11 and verse 6. He will rain coals of fire upon the wicked. Brimstone and burning wind will be the portion of their cup. Chapter 75, verse 8. Psalm 75, verse 8. And we read, for a cup is in the hand of the Lord, and the wine foams. It is well mixed, and he pours out of this. Certainly all the wicked of the earth must drain and drink its dregs. And we see that in Revelation when it talks about them drinking the cup of the wrath with the harlot in 17 and 18 especially. Okay, we also see it. Well, let me show you in Revelation. Go to Revelation 14. Revelation 14 and verse 10. Revelation 14:10. We read, he also will drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is mixed full strength in the cup of his anger, and he will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. This is when he goes into his suffering forever, because he's drinking the wine of the wrath of God in the cup of his anger. He has brought that on himself by wanting to be in God's place, usurping God, sitting on the throne. Can you imagine if he went and he was the God of this earth forever? I would say, Lord, help us, but nothing could help, that the Lord will never let that happen. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 19. We read, the great city was split into three parts. The cities of the nations fell. Babylon the Great was remembered in the sight of God to give her the cup of the wine of his first wrath, of his fierce wrath, forgive me, of his fierce wrath. The cup of the wine of the indignation, the wrath of God, you never want to drink that. And we won't. We are part of his body. We are safe from it, but it will be poured out on the earth in the tribulation and culminate in being cast into the lake of fire for the serpent. There is a cut deep and wide. It's fastened on the stars, or we see the stars if we go back to the crater, where the crater is sitting fastened. I'll put it that way. The crater is fastened to the serpent. Those stars where it's fastened there, the names show that it's a deep and wide cut. It is a writhing serpent. It shows that the curse of sin, the curse of evil, is fastened to him, and he is writhing under it. He is suffering the consequences now of what he's brought on himself. Now, it's interesting that the same stars which are in the foot of the cup form the part of the body of Hydra. So it's like the two are one, that cup of the wrath and Hydra. It's like they're one instead of two separate. The cup has 13 stars, and 13 is the number of apostasy. If you're apostatizing, you have turned from the true God to worship anything else, Satan or anything else. You are in that idolatry, that apostasy from the one true God. And the two stars that form the bottom of the cup on the body of the serpent are the name means the cup. That's why they pictured it like that. Okay, that brings us right next door to Corvus, the raven or the crow, right there to my left. It would be your right. That takes us back to Revelation 19. We're in 16, so just go over to Revelation 19. Revelation 19, verses 17 and 18. In Hebrew, the word is orab, and it means a raven. There's nine stars in Corvus. That's the number of judgment. So we've seen apostasy, and we've seen judgment. The birds of prey are devouring the serpent. That's the serpent's punishment. The birds of prey are being able to grasp the body of Hydra. They're being able to, with their feet, tear it, tear the serpent's body with its beak, with its feet. Basically, what we're seeing is a curse is inflicted on the serpent now, and the serpent is going down in death. This is Genesis 3:15 fulfilled, the death blow. That is what he is receiving now, and pictured by the wine, the apostasy, the wrath, the indignation of God, and the ravenous bird that is tearing the serpent to pieces. And the star names, yes.
Revelation 19 what?
Or Genesis?
Revelation 19, 17, and 18. Did I forget to read it? I haven't read it. I'll read Revelation 19, 17, and 18. But it's also fulfillment of Genesis 3:15, of that prophecy that we have talked about almost through every major constellation. Revelation 19, 17, and 18. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun. He cried out with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly amid heaven, come, assemble for the great feast of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of commanders, the flesh of mighty men, of horses, of those who sit on them, the flesh of all people, free and slaves, small and great. Remember, they're coming to the great supper, or the supper of the great God, really, is the way it should be said. That's a picture of what's happening here. That happens at the end of the tribulation, but what we are seeing for Hydra is at the end, after the millennium, when the serpent has been released, gone through the earth, gotten everybody who wants to follow him. They're coming up to come against the Lord and dethrone him, and God just basically opens up, and they fall into the lake of fire. Done away, or Satan falls in anyway, done away forever. The names and the stars of Corvus mean the enemy broken, the curse inflicted, the accursed. It means the raven, that's why we call it a raven. And the last one, star in there that we know, the name, it means the raven tearing to pieces. This is the ultimate end of Satan. This is the beginning of eternity, where there'll be a new earth. That this is the completion. This is the end of that circle now. It began with Virgo. We talked about that. It began with when the Lord took on human form. That's why we see it with Virgo. And it ends with Leo, when he comes back as that lion to rule and to reign and to bring death to the enemy, the serpent. That happens to be a picture of the Sphinx. The Sphinx has the head of a woman, or the head of a human anyway, and the body of a lion. And everybody says, this is the riddle of the Sphinx. What does it mean? It's actually believed that the riddle of the Sphinx was to tell them where to start in the zodiac in studying and where to end. Start with Virgo and end with Leo, the lion. I had a thought and went straight through. That's why I paused. The children of Israel, when they were in captivity in Egypt, the Sphinx had already been made. They go into captivity in about the 1800s. They're there for 400 years to about the mid-1400s. It's believed they came out somewhere around 1445 BC, and the Sphinx was made in 2000-something. I've got it in that overview. Let's see if I can find it real fast. The Sphinx was built in 2500 BC. So it would have been there. They could have seen it. The study could have gone on, you know, way back is what my point is, where to actually start down. Rather than jumping there with something of today, some will start with Aries, some starts with a different one. But I believe the Sphinx is the key and how well it fits Virgo to Leo.
Is that on the...
That would be on the paper I'm going to give you today. The meaning of the zodiac, its overview. It has a little bit more in there for you to read also. Again, when you read it, if it doesn't make sense because I wrote it when I was tired, just let me know. But we did it. It's 3:36, but we did it. That's the end of our study of the gospel and the stars. The glory of God so revealed, so clearly seen, and so amazing, so mind-blowing. What I want to close on is two notes. One is, we are here at this moment in time. While you are here on this earth, the choice is yours, whether you go into the glories and enjoy the glories forever, or where you go into the separation and the suffering that is forever. No one gets chosen for them. No one gets forced. It is by free will of man to choose. If you're listening out there in my Zoom world, out there in YouTube later, if you're listening in my living room, wherever you are, I just want to so encourage you. The God who created this all is a God who loves you so. He loves you so much that he came through that sky, put this lesson into the sky for us, that literally came down to earth and took on human form to rescue mankind. He did that for you. If you were the only one, he did it for you. Don't turn your back on him. Don't send yourself to eternity without him. Instead, realize he's reaching out to you with arms of love. All he wants to do is to make your life here better and bring you into the greater, better forever. But the choice is yours. We've seen a wonderful study that backs up the Word of God from beginning to end, from Bereshit, Genesis, to Revelation, in just another layer, just another format. No matter how you look at the Bible, archaeologically, mathematically, scientifically, astronomically, it shows you it's the inerrant Word of God. I'm not here preaching Rochelle's words. I'm not here telling you believe like Rochelle or be like Rochelle. Get Rochelle out of the way. Forget me, but don't forget my God. And realize,
amen.
He has given it so many different ways. It never disagrees. It never doesn't come together. It never argues. It is always concisely the same message. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him won't perish, but will have everlasting life. Do you see it in all its glory? Hallelujah. Yes. The heavens declare the glory of God. The glory of God is Yeshua Jesus, who loves you so. I plead with everyone and anyone who hears, if I know you, I want to see you with me in heaven one day. I know I'm going to be there.
I am.
I know it. I know it for a fact. I see it on some of the faces that are lit up right now, but I want you to know it too. And it's as simple as just in the privacy of your heart, opening up your heart. The Lord promises he will come in, and he promises you new life, and there is no one who has ever come back and said, well, I did that and it didn't work. Not one. Anyone who has truly done it sings his praises. We're going to close in prayer in a moment. We're going to open up the mics, but if you can hang 8 minutes and 47 seconds, I would love to show you again my favorite video that are the heavens declaring the glory of God. It is Giglio's. It is others that speak through it, but he was behind it putting it together. Again, it's a link I can give you, especially those of you who have to go and can't stay to see it, but it is such a mind blower with what we've just learned. I think you'll appreciate it all the more. So I'll close in prayer quick. I'll open for comments. But if you can hang tight when there the questions, comments, I see that, that you know we've done what we needed to do. We will put it on here. 8 minutes, 47 seconds, so you'll be out of here before 4. But if you can't hang and you want the link, let me know, okay?
You got the paper there, too.
Oh, yes, and I got to give you the papers, and I'll send to the others. Let's close with a word of prayer. Our God, creator of the heavens and the earth, who loves us so, we praise you and we thank you for this this study that does build our faith in you. How amazing and awesome the precise detail that you put in the stars and enacted out on earth. Lord, we stand in awe and we stand in amazement. And we praise you and we thank you that we can have that personal relationship and know that we will soar through these heavens, see the glories that you have created, and we don't even begin to know what else you've created for those who love you. Thank you for the precious and sure promise of eternity with you who loves us so forever. And Lord, I pray for any who haven't opened up, may they right now open and receive this. And those who have had, Lord, may they rejoice and shout out the hallelujahs and the amens. To God be the glory, the declaration of the heavens. In your holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.